But we need to go. What? Things that I need, you need to know. Don't play me like no silly old. Why you frontin' on my truck? What I need can't be too much. I need something that's rubber tough. Them roses ain't gon' be enough. All I need is something I have to comfort me on one night. So bring them diamonds, bring it out. Just make sure that you keep in mind.
I need a fist like that. Where she at? Where she at? I need a fist like that. Where she at? Where she at? I need a fist like that. Where she at? Where she at? I need a fist like that.
To me, then you ain't saying enough. I ain't about that bull drama, little boy. I need real things. Somebody help me say, ching ching a leg a leg. I know you're from the old school, but please get real. Baby girl, right here, got to pay her bills. I need a My name is Roxanne Shante. I started making hip-hop records in 1984, and I'm considered one of the first female rappers in hip-hop.
I'm Salt, from Salt and Pepper. My name is Cheryl James, and I'm originally from Brooklyn, New York.
Yo, what's up? This is the Big Kahuna. That's right. Pep's in the house. This is Pepper from Salt and Pepper. That's right.
Hi, I'm Nikki D. Some might remember me as the first female rapper on Def Jam.
Yo, what's up? This Heather B coming straight from Jersey City, New Jersey. Word up.
The Lady of Rage is from Farmville, VA. Virginia, that is, for those who don't know.
What's up? I'm Queen Penn. I'm from Brooklyn.
How y'all doing? Name is Marijuana. Like the new hottest female rapper out from Jersey.
My name is Charlie Baltimore, and I'm from Philadelphia. West Philly, representing West Philly.
Peace, this is Rod. The first and only female to flip mode squad coming to you live.
My name is Shireen Newton now, I'm married. I'm from the group Vanessa Sinquist.
Yo, what up, what up? This Champ, the Gasso, AKA Shorty Bug Thug, the Scorpion, Venom number 4.
Yo, what up? This is Jay Boo, Venom number 1, AKA Viper the Swashes, representing Queensbridge, baby.
What's up, this is the Poetess, representing with the Miss MC documentary.
My name is Bonnie Clyde from the Bronx.
My name is Preeta Honey Dark from Far Rockaway, Queens.
How you doing? I'm Lady Luck, Def Jam's new recording artist. I'm originally from my father's nutsack. I went to my mother's womb. I spent 9 months in there. And then after that, you know, we just been moving around like gypsies.
What's up, y'all? This is Camille Young representing Dirty Jersey.
What's up, everybody? My name is Steph Lover. That's L-O-V-A, all right? Don't get it twisted.
I'm Medusa, representing West Coast, representing Feline Science, and right now, representing Miss MC.
When you're the first at something, usually they say, okay, well, you bust open doors. But no, when I got in hip-hop, the doors were still held open for you.
Those who try to disrespect me, you better cut that crap or get slapped. Cause Shantae is back on the map.
You know, I may have bust open doors as far as being the first female to do it, but then it wasn't as competitive as it is now. It wasn't as shiesty as it is now, even though they were still there stealing and there thieving, and you know, and I have had a lot stolen.
Me and Sandy met in college. We were going to community college, and we were in our first year.
And that was my girl. We was just hanging out. And then we also worked at the same job, which was Sid's.
Kid and Play worked there. I think y'all heard this before. But Martin Lawrence worked there. Our producer, Herbie Lovebug, worked there. And he was going to a school called Center for the Media Arts in Manhattan. He had to do a project, whereas he had to have actually press a record, go to the pressing plant, and come back with a mastered record.
I wrote the rhymes, gave it to them, asked them if they would do it. They said, yeah, yeah, sure, sure, whatever. And
he asked me and Pep to do the vocals. Like, yo, we could do this. Y'all could be Salt and Pepper. It ended up being The Showstopper, which is the answer to Dougie Fresh and Slick Rick's The Show. And I was like, I'm not dissing Dougie Fresh and Slick Rick. Are you mad? You know, Lottie Dottie, are you crazy? So he was like, yo, I'm telling you, we could do this. So we went into the attic, in Herbie's attic, started doing music, put the music together, made a tape. And we got our foot in the door. This little independent record label called us. They still owe us money, and they pressed the record for us.
And from then on, they were just, you know, just kept doing it.
So before you know it, clubs was calling us, and we was traveling, doing shows. We quit our jobs, we quit school, and the rest is history.
My first solo banger was Daddy's Little Girl. And basically, I'm born and raised in Newark, New Jersey. And we got to a point in life where my mother got to a point in life where she wanted to switch up and change. So we wound up moving to LA. I wound up going to high school for the 4 years out there, and that's where I started rapping at. Got involved with Ice-T, Evil E, who was a DJ, and the LA Posse, who actually got me a demo done so it can go into Russell Simmons' hands and he can actually hear it.
I gotta say that Russell's like daddy to me. No, Russell, first let me say that I love you. Russell gave me the opportunity to start my career and be part of such a big industry that had no love for females, especially female rappers at that point. And once he put me on, I couldn't do nothing but shine for him, and he gave me a big record, Daddy's Little Girl.
But I mean, in the midst of all of that, it was really not as easy as I make it sound because I was 18. You know, me and my friend was like, okay, hey, we're just gonna sell a Volkswagen Bug and we're gonna get our little $1,000 and we're gonna buy some bus tickets and we're gonna go over to New York and we're gonna get this record done and we're gonna get this deal. So, you know, me being the trooper that I am, I lied to my mother. I was like, Russell waiting for me, Ma. She was like, you know, ain't nobody waiting for you over there. I was like, Ma, Russell's waiting for me. He want me to come. The contract is already there. Because when I was about 15, 16, I signed away some crazy deal with some lady doing a soundtrack that never came out, but she had gotten my publisher for it. My mother thought that was crazy, so after that, she was like, don't sign no more papers. Whatever the case, me and my friend Dawn, we just, you know, we blacked out. And we came to New York, because the producers were out in New York, the LA Posse. And they was like, well, if you get out here, you know what I'm saying, we can sneak you in the studio, we can do your demo, la, la, la. So basically, that's what happened. Snuck me in, we did two songs. They got it over to Russell, because they were working on LL Cool J's album. And they got it over to Russell.
I basically got started in 92 with KRS-One and Boogie Down Productions. I went to school with Kenny Parker, who was Chris's brother, and that's how we hooked up. And it was ill, because at the time, Boogie Down Productions was like, bam, like on top. And it was just, I don't know, it was just perfect timing for me to get in. And Chris was a good teacher, someone to learn from, especially how to write songs. He took me out traveling. I just basically spent 2 years just traveling and writing and doing things and how to become an artist before I came out with my own record.
I used to write poetry a lot, and when I first heard the Sugar Hill Gang and Grandmaster Flash, that was just an extension of poetry. You know, it just had music added to the element, so I figured, you know, this is something I can do, and I started writing when I was like 10, 11. I met a lot of people. Even though people were up on my skills and everything, nobody really took an interest in me. I worked with Eric B for a while. I was down with Nikki D, the LA Posse, who worked with LL Cool J, and then Chubb Rock. And Chubb Rock was about to do something with me until that's when Dre called for me. Got a call. I was working at Chung King Studios, also living there for those who know the story. And I got a call from Dre. He was like, Dre and Suge, and they were like, we heard you on the LA Posse compilation. We're forming a new rap label, or new record label, and we wanted to know if you wanted to be down with it. And I was like, well, how do I know you're Dr. Dre? And he was like, there's only one way to find out. And they sent me a ticket.
I rock rough and stuff with my Afro punks.
Rock on with your man.
Still kicking up dust.
If you
look at back in the days, it was at the time where I started when I was like 14, 15, wasn't much at that time for us to do but to hang on the corner and rhyme. And the guys around my way where I grew up used to always rhyme, and I just started writing rhymes. I started out by writing songs, but that's how my moms found my songs and took them from me because I was not doing right in school. So I just started writing rhymes because it was easier to hide them from her. So that's how I basically started rhyming. I used to be in Virginia or whatever, and a friend of mine that's locked up now was close with Teddy. And I used to be around Teddy, but I don't want to bull ride and say, yo, Teddy, I can rhyme. And one day I told him, he was like, word, come to the studio. So I went down to the studio, I rhymed for him, and he was honest with me. He said, yo, I can't do nothing for you right now, but I'm trying to get my own deal, my own label, and when I do, I'm gonna come back for you. And when he did No Diggity, which was 2 years later, he found me in Brooklyn.
She's a magnificent. The queen.
Writing poetry, you know, in like second, third grade, and I guess it just kind of developed into, you know, rapping.
Who's the one that came in bitch? Everything I touch is y'all want to get it. Cats want to hit it. Hype when I spit it. What y'all do did it. Want to get it? Want to get rich? I'm going to show you money. And you want a hot chick? Gotta throw your money. Why you want to hate me? I don't know you money. Y'all cats got late fees. I don't owe you money.
I think by the time I was in sixth and seventh grade, that's when Big Daddy Kane first came out with Raw. That's what I remember, me writing a rap, me listening to that and just being really inspired to try to rap like him and be like him and write a rhyme. And went to school and like spit for the boys that was in my class. And they used to be like, yo, you sound like Big Daddy Kane. So we would go in the schoolyard and battle, and I was like the only girl in my class that raps. It was just crazy that I worked in the gallery in Philly, which is like a little mall, like in the center of Philly. And I was like about 14 or 15. And Will Smith came in the mall. And God forbid he would remember this, which I doubt he would, but he came in the mall and he was in the Athlete's Foot. And I ran out of the store that I worked in and got him in, you know, the hallway and rapped for him. You know, and I gave him my number, and he actually called and was like, yo, you know, you should come out. I think that you would be hot. You know, you got skills. And, like, I lived with my sister, and she was like, you know, you can't go out after such and such a time. So it kind of, you know, discouraged me from doing it. And, of course, it started back up again when I met Big, you know, and I was just playing around one day, rapped. It was just as simple as him telling me to keep writing, you know, and which I did. So for like 2 years, you know, I just kept writing, improving my skill from years of not writing, you know. So it didn't take long for me to be able to write songs, and I didn't really know how to structure them well, but I mean, you know, all that came in time, so.
Basically, it's been a long time coming for me, you know what I'm saying? For those of y'all that know me personally, I've been rhyming since a little teeny tiny girl at the age of 12, elementary school. From there, I just basically continue writing throughout high school.
Flip mode, outsiders, tight, down to the
ground. Hey, man.
Yeah, check it.
And I
say what's tight, cause it's just the right rhymes all day and all night. Dwelling south of the Hudson, New Jerusalem, in seclusion, using fake pseudonyms.
I'm true bad.
Mind travels like a schizo on two tabs with do-rags hanging from my pockets. Need a rap to go back to pediatric. Early less rappers like you were straight vested. So recognize.
We decided to pursue this as a career in my early years of college. I left college, and from that point on, I was basically broke. All the way up until the time I got a record deal. So for all you aspiring artists, you know what I'm saying, just stick with your dreams and it'll definitely happen. A little bit about myself personally. I come from Brick City, Newark, New Jersey.
First thing first, I started as a solo artist. You know what I'm saying? We ain't gonna talk about the label because it don't mean nothing. You know what I'm saying? But I'm with a group now, you know what I'm saying? And I think we top dogs. We top choice in this bitch. You know what I'm saying? We run this motherfucker right here. And I feel like, yo, straight up, we write our own fucking lyrics. You know what I'm saying? That's first thing first. I think we get popped for that. Because a lot of motherfuckers be here, motherfuckers rapping and shit. Oh, that shit is hot? Yeah, but your man wrote it. You know what I'm saying? And niggas is getting credit for shit they ain't do. But you know what I'm saying? I'm not the one to bite your motherfucker head off. I just do me. You know what I'm saying?
Back in 1980, somewhere around that time. I think I was like eight or, I'm 27 now, so I started rhyming when I was like eight. When I was in Brooklyn, what happened was the people on the block used to battle each other verse to verse, and they used to win money. They used to get money from each other that way. And so what I used to do when I was little is I used to go up and recite other people's rhymes. At that time, I wasn't really into writing or anything like that. And I would battle those, the older cats, they weren't really that old, it was like 14, 15, but still, to me, they were older. I would battle them, and make my little 50 cents or a dollar, because they would just give it to me to get away. And then after a while, I started like filling in other people's verses with my words. And then like around 10 or 11, I actually started writing down verses, writing down rhymes. And most of it was basically about life, what I wanted, because at that time, I really didn't have, as what a lot of people didn't really have anything, basically. So it was like, you write a lot about what you want, what you wish for, what you hope for, and things like that. And then eventually it just developed into what it is today. Like, I didn't start like battling, basically. Well, battling is like something that's always around. Like, you'll just be walking down the street and someone will just, call you out. Or even if you're in a freestyle with someone, they'll just, you're just going at it, blow for blow. That's like being an MC, you know what I mean? But it's not like no hard feelings. Real MCs, it's not really no hard feelings. Your ego isn't crushed or anything like that. You're just, you're just rhyming. I didn't get into like the mainstream battles, or, reference to like the Vibe battles, the Blaze battles and things like that, till around 96, when I won the Vibe magazine battle. And in 98, it was the Blaze magazine battle.
Off the top. You see, a bitch is a female dog, a dog barks, a bark is up the tree, a tree is nature, nature is beautiful, and thank you for the compliment. You ain't stopping this, you think I'm gonna flinch it. I pull down your pants, I bet so I count 3 inches. You get fucked up when you talk, that's how I'm gonna stop. I knew you told me sexual. And if you don't believe I got it going on, I'll be on www.getyourass.com.
It was cool. The problem that I had with those battles was that a lot of people, felt that I had won because I was a woman, basically. There were, in both battles, I was the only female. So a lot of people thought, she won because she was a woman or whatever, and things of that nature, which I totally disagree upon, because it's like every time you try to, every time you try to do something or every time you succeed in something as a woman, they say it's because you're a woman. You're either sexing someone because someone liked you, or whatever the case may be. They don't believe that you actually sit down and write, because whenever I go to a venue, the first thing they say is, do you write your own rhymes? Or, or is that you rhyming, or does someone else do this for you? But I don't see them asking anyone else that same question. So at these battles, all of that was thrown at me. I got into some beef here and there, with about it, but whatever.
When we first signed with Uptown, it wasn't hard. It fell into our lap. It was like God sent. We wasn't looking for a record deal. It was just me and her. me and Sydney, her name is Sydney Finesse, and we were both on the basketball team in high school, John Brown in Queens. And I had went up to her and said, you know, you want to be in a group? And she was like, fine. Back then, we were young. We were just down for anything. And this guy had told us that Andre Harrell was living in Left Rack. That's where I'm from. I lived in Left Rack at the time. And they was like, he's looking for, you know, some groups, you know, and maybe he could hook it up. And then it ended up getting hooked up.
My cousins, they was living with me for a minute, you know what I mean? My mother let them, because, you know, my mother, she be doing her thing. Not her thing, but doing her thing. My cousins were staying with us for a minute. And they was listening to Biz Markie, picking boogies and on the toilet and stuff like that, and Big Daddy Kane. I said, I wanted to do that. I told my mother, me and her was up one morning, and I was writing Cat, Hat, Bat, and my mother wrote my first rhyme for me. Then after that, you know what I mean, I've been writing my own joints. My own joints. Me. Not you. I mean, I was rhyming for a while, and then, like, you know, I always been the one with the hat to the back, the baggy jeans and stuff. So dudes wouldn't really, you know what I'm saying, give me play, whatever, like that, because I've always been a tomboy. You know what I mean? It's more fun. Girls, Barbies, I was the one with the G.I. Joes. You know what I mean? They kill each other and stuff. That was more fun. You know what I'm saying? And then, like, nobody really give me play. I was rhyming, and then, like, I was going to give up. I was like, you know, I'm just going to finish high school, go do me. You know what I'm saying? I'm only 17, writing my own rhymes. And then, you know what I'm saying? I rhymed on Hot 97. I battled people for 5 days straight. I won. Went up there on the sixth day with Ed and Steph Lover. And after that, Kevin Lyles called up. Mad people called up. And Ed and Steph, they took me over. DJ Enough, they took me over to Def Jam. I rhymed for Kevin, and he liked it, but he was like, yo, da-da-da-da-da-da, we'll give you this, and da-da-da-da-da-da, but we don't want to sign you if you don't want to be here. He said, you got a demo? I played my demo. He called Leo. Leo said, do the deal.
The way we met Anomalies, I mean, I knew Helix since 95. We used to go through all the hip-hop events, just rolling around, going to the same shows, and then we just started kicking it, and I said, she was an MC, and I was a DJ, and me and her got together, and we were like, you know, we know mad people, we know B-girls, we know graph writers. They were all friends. We just met each other through going to events, and she knew a couple people from she went to high school, and we just all just started kicking it together. So me and her were like, you know, she's an MC, I'm a DJ, and there's a B-girl right there, and we just got together. Next thing you know, we formed the name Anomalies, and I mean, Haley's can break part of that down for you and how the name Anomalies came about.
Well, Anomalies actually means a deviation from a natural order. It's something that comes once every millennium. So pretty much we figured that would be the, I guess, the best thing to describe what we were trying to do. We just wanted to create something that was totally different and take things to the next level.
Yeah, if you look at the word anomaly in the dictionary, it says something out of the norm, uncommon, something different. And we women, as part of Anomalies of Hip Hop, we're different from your average female. I think a lot of females that come out, you'd either have to, if you see them now, most of them are known to either A, you're like on some woman, like female, like all trick thing, sexual thing, or you're either like some hardcore, like gangster rap or something like that.
But we were starting a women's division in the nation, and we met like a lot of different individuals along the course of that. So as a group, how we got together was the same thing like Cutting Candy. Me and her started talking about how we could just bridge everything together and take it to new heights. Mm. So as time progressed, we met a lot more different people, all spectrums of the world. And it just got crazy. So we took, we just took everybody. It was like a big melting pot. It was like, all right, you B-girl, you DJ, you graph, you MC, you do clothing. Pretty much whatever you did, it was like, just come through and, you know, we can make this happen.
All right, stop what you're doing, because I'm about to ruin the image and the style that you used to. Yeah, I'm a chica, but still I blow your speakers. See, the whole world, I hope you're ready for me. So gather round. White, black, yellow, and brown. I got flow, it's like H2O, making you drown. Anomalies, the crew, I don't go for Delph. but just let me introduce myself. My name's Invincible. I pounce when I'm dissing you. I got the shit you wanna listen to. If we battle, I'm bringing out the bitch and you. Rap with tactics that won't sacrifice principle. See, I'm militant and not concealing it. I point it to the sky like a Black Panther. Then name it to your feet, turn you to a dancer. Y'all need to move, son. Sick of seeing these crews fronting. Burn your whole folder, then roll over and hit the snooze button. The daytime's when I hibernate. Nights when I slay rhymes, cause I'm wide awake. Call me the Mike Insomniac. Rhyming to remind you that you're not ill, just a hypochondriac. Listen to the mission, cause I'm fiending the rap. Till I'm a legend like the key in the map. The ill convoy, tomboy. Doing this since fourth grade on the Casio. And I still got a nasty flow. It's like that for them bitch assholes. Okay, Invincible is the name. Anomaly's the crew. Everything to gain, nothing to lose, y'all. Everything to gain, nothing to lose, y'all. Everything to gain, nothing to lose.
The way I started rapping was like starting in elementary school. I wrote poetry and it just grew into loving rap. I listened to Tupac, Biggie, all the great influences. And it was like, hip-hop was a part of me, even when growing up, dancing, from everything, the parties, everything. So I just turned into rap, you know? I love this hip-hop, you know? Walking the door, bitches giving me looks. The room filled with ballin' niggas and crooks. Rich niggas that shook, pretty young thing. Educated, don't talk with no slang. Had these niggas in the trance off the way my ass swang for their desires. Imagine how much joy I would bring, but intimidated when he seen the diamonds all in my rings, but called me mommy. And told me he can tell me some things, but if he wasn't filthy rich, then he was living a dream. And if he wasn't getting money, wasn't joining the team. Cause ain't no use for a nigga who can't produce no cream. That's what I mean. When it get rough, put coke on them beams. Support some fiends. You guarantee for big heads that's green to blow the scene. Cause when you dough right, these niggas gon' scheme. And don't you ever leave your house without carrying that thing.
For me, it was just like, you know, a teenage fit in kind of thing. But as I got older, like, it just became like, you know, that guy that you can't have. And you just, you own him. You own him in the club, you own him in the wherever, you own him. And yo, that's how it is. That's how it is right now.
I've been doing this for quite a while. Not that I think it being a male-dominated sport, we might as well call it, is what held me back. I think me fine-tuning my skills and who I am and the way I present and represent is what is making this what it is. And it's not even a struggle. It's a perfection of your art.
I really had to put my foot down for a deal. I had to be like, okay, look, I want my deal, I want it now, or I'm not rapping anymore. You know, which I would have still been rapping, but that's just what I said in order to get my deal. Of course, I had 5-6 labels waiting for me to sign, but that individual did not want me to know that. Of course, he wanted to make more money off of me. But thank God that I knew, you know, because I know people in the industry, and they were calling me personally saying, Paula, come down here, come down there, we want to sign you. And I'm like, well, I heard y'all didn't want to sign me, so that just kind of made me flip out. So when I got the deal, when I got in the record company, I was signed to 3 different labels. The first label I was signed to was Loose Cannon. I thought it was a good label. You know, the people there, sweethearts, I love everybody there, but one thing they lacked was the knowledge of marketing a record. The marketing skills were, you know, it wasn't no good marketing skills. It wasn't nobody really behind me pushing my product. When I got to the next label, which was Mercury, that was a fairly good label. I finished an album on Mercury, that was cool. Then I've got on Motown, and they merged. So this is just a long, long cycle I've been going through with all these different record labels. You know what I mean? They're merging to Universal. All the whole staff there got fired. So it's not only on the artists, it's on the workers as well. It's on the A&Rs, it's on the whoever works at the label, you know, all their careers is at hand. Just listening to the radio, listening to Queen Latifah, MC Light, you know, all the early female rappers, you know, that kind of influenced me a big deal. I need my VA splash, do a 50-yard dash up on this bitch ass like she stole something.
Rest in peace to Flo Jo, I move swift through these ghetto blocks, yo. Boat knocker, banaka blast, watch my ass, put the cash in the safe. I'm safe on the Ave, cause I'm streetwise, did a 9 to 5. Saving, slaving, getting by, can't try. This fly chick, and watch my lips, I never snitch. I'm loyal to my kisses, unforgiving sins. Friends, I don't need them like a Benz. I ride a 650 dirt bike, no skirts, Tim's, the average gems. Flowing like my hair in the wind, amen. I'm raising up out of hell, y'all wait to exhale. I'ma inhale this next L. Paula Perry to fail, ain't in my vocabulary. That's why I never worry and I'm never gonna stop. So never worry, you hear me? Haha, P niggas.
What really inspired me to rap was as a youngster, I used to talk all the time.
Badass, ruthless bitches. That's what I heard.
And it was a choice. I grew up like on 110th and Western West Side. So it was a choice. Either I was gonna be like the Dub C's and the Ice Cubes and write rhymes, or I was gonna be in the hood and activate and do active things in the streets. So I chose to, since I talk all the time, let me start flowing.
Since the first time I saw ya, I knew I was attracted, reacted to the fact on how you make me act. Shy but sexy at the same time, all was on my mind was a little bump and grind. Usually I don't play it that close, you got to kick it with me before I serve you up with an overdose of this silky little mommy. Make you my man, ain't got no love for nobody else but you. My boo, I prove to you, my love be true. So do you know where you're going to? Through thick and thin.
I was like pretty much my own inspiration through poetry, through drama, through growing up in LA. It was like the only thing I can do is write to get these expressions out. So at the age of like 13, I got into it and went to Henry Clay, had my Kango hat on in the 9th grade, yearbook. They was like the best rappers.
Basically, GBM was a whole concept of a remake of N.W.A., just females coming out of South Central, just rapping about what we go through our everyday lively, you know, and we just came together. Eric bought us some khakis and chucks and t-shirts and told us to put it on, and we got to doing hard songs and doing shows, and that's how we became GBM.
Personally, I think all them bitches crazy than a motherfucker.
Pure uncut, what the fuck? Back up in this piece, so how they cease and hush, but they ain't doing too much. Running lips while I pop clipping, caught you slipping while I'm dipping. It comes naturally when you got a GB mentality. Staying equipped for them hoes who oppose and wanna battle me. I'ma ride a check the saddle, see? Straight out the west, instigate for the papes, using these buses for bait. I can't wait, that's why I keep it moving. Diamond shining, and that's the point I'm proving. No illusions, I'ma ride this when I get open like garages. My lyrical squad hovering like a sly bitch. Make them twitch to this type dope. Got them praying like the Pope off this murder dad I wrote. So don't quote me, cuz I ain't said shit. It's easy, it's easy to get lit. Don't get me pissed. I insist on getting you all damn hype. And when you with a G, you know it's all damn night. And maybe to the sunrise with no surprise. And you wonder why I'm so fly. It's the GB and me. Make them wanna holler my mentality. All about my dollars, I just wanna see my player partners pop their collars. Cause D.I.E. remains a street scholar. Yeah, now, yeah, we tearing it up. Yeah, I'm Diamond D coming at you. You know, you ain't heard of me, but I'm behind the scenery slowly doing some debuts, and that Silky Fine coming at you. But Honey West. Silky Fine coming back as Honey West. And I dare any bitch to try to test. Under my nest remains the vest, low tolerance. See what I do to a pest. It ain't no telling when Jack told Helen. Since you said I hit ya, try to catch me when I'm belling. In my silk suit, always looking cute, kick kick, or get stuck in your Duke shoots. We ain't playing.
And I've been in the rap game for about 14 years now, since 86. And I started out as an intern for a record company. And then I ran into some people that were into rap music, Def Jeff, and I did a demo. Like Rage said earlier, she started out writing poetry at a very young age, and the same goes for myself. So I teamed up with a producer by the name of Def Jeff, and he did a demo for me. And we shopped the deal for a couple of years, and I finally got signed to a label called Poetic Groove, which was really the first independent label on Interscope before Death Row. And I released a single called Love Hurts, which addresses domestic violence. And I did that cut with Def Jeff, Almighty, Cool G Rap, and myself, of course. And that was in 1992.
I pretty much started, I was like doing shows. I won the Rap Masters in Newark. And that like big contest.
Open it straight down the holes. We do trouble like an accident. I get president. We make this even Italian accents. Illegal aliens. Pet pushes and pussy dancers. Money overlookers. Fight hitters doing jobs for coke hookers. Saving my weakness. I ain't trying
to. A lot of rappers. Then I came to Brooklyn. I did a couple of shows in Brooklyn. I won some of those. I did shows all over.
I started rapping about 5 years ago. I was in this female group, about three of us. And it worked out for about 6 months. Then I found out females, you know, it's kind of hard to have three females work together. I don't know, I guess we're not really used to it yet, you know. I guess when rap gets larger, we'll learn how to deal with each other and get along like the fellas do. So anyway, everybody did their thing, and I left it alone for about 5 years until March this year. I was in college working at Avis. And I just decided, I was like, this ain't for me, I want to rap. So went back into rap.
Really, I got inspired to start making hip-hop records. Everything was really by accident. It wasn't something that I really wanted to do. It was something that was pushed on me. It was something like I was just in the right place at the right time, so they say.
At that time, it was Roxanne, Shantae, it was Sparky D. It was a few females in the beginning. Sparky D, as a matter of fact, is somebody who taught me a lot about the business and about how to present myself on stage.
Just the fans. I mean, like I said, watching at the time Roxanne, Shantae and stuff. I mean, I was going watching her, you know, and there were Sparky D out and all the other, you know, there was a few female rappers out and at the time, and then actually getting my foot in the door and actually being a part of it, and then just seeing the response from people, like my fans.
Lawyers. You have to have lawyers, you have to review contracts, and you also have to prepare for life after hip-hop. Hip-hop life and any entertainment life, like modeling and all those other different lives, you have to be prepared when you can no longer do that. Because if you are not prepared, there's no telling what can possibly happen.
Be original, be yourself. People that last are people who make music from the heart. You know, they always say keep it real, and some people felt like Salt and Pepper wasn't keeping it real. I made music that I liked. I wrote lyrics that I liked. If I would have put on a bandana and started, you know, acting hard, then I wouldn't have been keeping it real. So keep it real as far as write songs that come from your heart. And the public, they're not stupid. You know, they know when you're putting on an act and they know when it's real or not.
I have to say, my advice to females coming up, it's real important. My main thing is really important to be on top of your business. I think that's like the main thing, first of all, to really be involved with your business. I mean, I know it's sad because you come into this business not to be a lawyer, you come into this business not to be an accountant, but you have to actually become a lawyer and accountant and be creative at the same time.
Be educated, do your work, and try to do all of your writing and get into producing and get all that money, because that's what keeps you. That's what makes your career more longevity.
I mean, you gotta be the new hot DMX. You gotta be the hot Jay-Z. You gotta be the new Foxy Brown. You gotta be, you always gotta be a step high. You cannot be what they are because we already have that. So you always have to look and say, well, damn, how can I be different? How can I make it happen?
Pray, word, just keep God. Whatever your religion is or whatever your thing is, put God first. Get out. A's for all the love that I get and that I've given. B for all my brothers locked down in the system. C, some say I'm crazy, but I'm conscious of what I'm doing. So CC for conscious, in case you overlooked it. D for don't, E forever, F front like we fam. When you know you cut my throat to be exactly where I am. G, I thank God. H, I'm reaching higher heights. Heather, hold it down. Heather don't need no hype.
Never give up. Always follow your dreams, and because people don't realize when you come from a certain environment and you have so many obstacles against you.
I don't know. I think that you have to make sure that your business part is straight before everything else. That's probably like the most important thing, because you'll get so sucked up into the game. And like if you're successful right off of the bat, like say you drop a song that's hot, you'll have so many people that are coming out of nowhere, like, telling you so much different shit. You won't know what's what. You won't be able to differentiate between, is this person keeping it real, or are they just dick riding me because I'm hot right now?
Don't, whatever ideas or whatever images you have for yourself as far as how you want to portray yourself and your image, don't be blindsided by what you see on TV.
Y'all feel like this? Make up your own mind, y'all. Don't let nobody tell you wrong. Know what I'm saying? Just keep writing and writing till your shit get mad tight. Just keep your shit on the right schedule, you know what I'm saying? For the people that want to get up in this game, it ain't no motherfucking cake and ice cream in this bitch. Everybody want to eat. So if you trying to get into what we trying to get into, just keep it real. Be true to yourself. Because this here right here is a fucking struggle, and just do you, yo. Don't let nobody tell you nothing else, nothing wrong.
Keep
your own attention. Yo, listen to the rhythm shit, y'all. Somebody better handle their business. I was at the wrong place at the wrong time. I gave the wrong side. Now I'm walking up the crooked line with the quickness. A witness. Somebody better handle their business. You heard me?
Yeah.
When you're in the business, you can't just really rely on being an artist. You have to really learn and branch out and try to reach other aspects of the business, because if not, being an artist, there might be some downtime. You'll be like, dang, what am I gonna do? So while you're in the business, and I'm telling this to all the sisters and brothers out there struggling, trying to come up in the business, learn all you can while you can. Just because you're an artist doesn't mean that, okay, I don't need to learn about all that other stuff, but you do. You gotta really know the dichotomy of what makes up an artist, what makes up the business, and all that. And again, the minute you sign a contract to a record company, you automatically become a business person.
Need to start rhyming more about what they feel. You know what I mean? You need to start rhyming about what you feel. Rhyme about your child. Rhyme about you. Rhyme about what's inside. You know what I mean? Don't rhyme about things that, you know, everyone else is rhyming about just because of that fact, just because you want to sell a record, just because, you know, because those are the people who generally make records.
This doesn't happen overnight, and read any contract very carefully, everything, the fine printed lines, and seek counseling, seek professional help dealing with contracts. Don't take a contract and just sign it yourself and give it back to the whomever, because it's no telling what's on that contract. You can sign your whole life away for all you know. Just get professional advice and just keep going. Just go for your goal and don't let nobody stop you. Don't let nobody hold you back, and be wise.
You know what I'm saying? I can tell the female MCs, when you first want to rap, I mean, you first know that you want to rap, be you. Because if you notice that, it'll sell what you listen to on the radio. It's selling now. So instead of writing like that, be different, because there's always going to be that different MC who comes out, and you may not think that shit is going to sell, but it blows up. You know what I'm saying? I mean, look at Missy. Missy came out with something totally different. You know what I mean? Came out, she's an R&B singer, rapping, so just be yourself and be you. Ain't nobody going to have faith in you if you don't have it in yourself.
I would say do it for the love and not the money, because the money come and go. You can't take it with you, you know? But somehow I think you can take the love with you, you know. I think you can. You should. I mean, because it's not physical as far as materialistic, but it's so real, you know. And if you love what you'll do, you'll do it regardless if there was money involved or not. So do it for the love. Don't sell yourself out, you know.
I would have to say the advice would be to be patient and to really perfect what you're doing. Don't think because you have a few verses written or a couple of songs written that you're ready and you're on point with it, because it takes so much more than that, you know. It takes fine-tuning, for sure. And you have to have a library of songs, you know. Come with a couple of albums, not just a couple of songs, you know.
Before, hip-hop has really not affected my family life at all, because I didn't start my real family life until I retired from hip-hop. And it sounds kind of funny, but I literally retired at like 22. So life started for me in a whole different path. I started living life after hip-hop.
My family has always been most important to me. And when I had my daughter especially, I took her everywhere with me that I could, you know, that wasn't too hard for her to travel. She basically grew up on the road. A lot of people were telling me, you know, that's not good for a kid. And I feel like it was more important for her to be with her mom than anything else, or stable environment at home or whatever, you know. And still to this day, I take my daughter on the road. She's 8 and she's in the 3rd grade. She's just going to 3rd grade. But I'll take a tutor out if I'm gonna be out too long. And I have a newborn now, so it's even harder now because I'm traveling with the both of them a lot. But I've always kept a real relationship with my sister, my mom, my dad. I don't bring salt and pepper home. When I'm home, we don't talk about salt and pepper. It ain't about salt and pepper. It's about us just being together. It's about family, and that's always been very important to me. And it hasn't really affected my close relationships at all.
I just recently had a daughter, Zakiya. She's 17 months. And so, you know, in the beginning of this, it didn't affect, you know, my family at all. My grandmother and my aunts and everybody, they were kind of worried about me because I was just out in this big world by myself, you know, chasing a dream. And they were worried, you know, when I was living at Chungking and, you know, not really having a place to stay and just not complaining. I just did what I had to do. I'm not asking nobody for a handout. You know, I'm gonna get mine on my own, or, you know, with help with somebody. But, you know, that probably affected them for a while, worrying right. and stuff like that.
I mean, it affects it in good and bad ways, because, like I said, I have 3 children. And I had my first child when I was 16, so my kids is 9 and 10, and then I have a newborn 6 months. And when you have to travel a lot of times your children don't understand. I mean, now I can provide properly for my children, but there's always a con, it's pros and cons. So basically it's like, all right, my son, I can buy him things that he wants, but he has to understand and respect that just because I'm a rapper, it don't come easy. So that's why I drag him with me to, like, he's in the car, I make him see that this is just more than mommy going away, me being on videos, you seeing me on TV performing, it's mommy working, which I feel is important in any field that a female works, a single mother works, because it's important for your kids to know where it comes from so they can appreciate it. So my family, my personal life, my family, it's all affected because I travel, I have long hours, I sometimes get irritated, I snap. So, but I mean, at least I can provide for my children and for my family now.
But probably the hardest thing for me in the game is the fact that I don't get to spend as much time with my daughters. I have 2 daughters that I would like to, you know. And it's difficult, but at the same time, it's important for me to do whatever I can to establish a future for them, you know. No matter what it costs me, you know, I'm not really, like, I'm concerned. Of course, I would be about my future, but if I can secure them a better, you know, a better future than what I had growing up, you know, I'll do that by all means necessary.
Well, as far as my family, they've always been supportive as far as me, you know, choosing this as my career. My father's side of the family, they're real staunch with school. Like, everyone is college, grad school, PhDs, like the whole 9. So I was like the cousin that didn't finish college and decided to take this route. And, you know, you can't really explain to people, oh, I'm gonna be rich, or, you know, I'm gonna be a star, it's gonna happen. Like, they don't really get it until, you know, they see it actually happening. And even when it's actually happening, like, they're not really getting it. Like, everyone around them gets it first. And then it's like, wow, you know, cousin is really, you know, doing her thing. So it was a little bit of a struggle. It got a little tense at times, but, you know, thanks to my parents for not kicking me out until, you know, things fell through. But they definitely stuck by me. I always had a home base, you know, when things wasn't looking too bright as far as the industry was concerned. You know, I always had a stable home, and I was able to actually be comfortable until I got to this point.
My family life, well, it didn't really affect it too much, but, you know, I have a lot of people that were kind of like mad at me because they felt that I wasn't spending enough time with them. I was spending a lot of time, you know, doing my thing in the studio.
Or, you know, they just figure, well, she got money, well, why she ain't, you know what I'm saying? But it's not like that. It wasn't like that. You know what I'm saying? I have my life. I had to just go on and just go for it, regardless of what anybody thought.
Well, you know, and my father's a punk, you know what I'm saying? I don't like him. But my step-pops, it's my nigga right there, if we could say that. You know what I'm saying? That's my best friend. And he be rhyming with me. He come freestyle. He come, and whoever come over and rhyme with me in my basement, he'll punch him in the chest. You gotta come harder than that, nigga.
Hey, yeah. Hey, yo, niggas be partying, touching my body, getting talking about like I'ma get the guardian today, he on mine, tomorrow he on hers. Don't worry, playboy, see, I knew what it was. Same thugs wanna freak first, tell them to eat first. Half on the baby, let's go half on these drinks first. I'm thinking champagne, he thinking champagne. He screaming, I'm a rap star, but did your shit sell? My chain sick, add diamonds till it get well. Put the house, cars, rocks on it, I'm a big girl. With them big things that bounce when I run. You with a junior hot chick, barely blossom. Look, I'll be wifey up until the cops come. Get this broad off me, knock to your pop one. Never ride shotgun, I handle the wheel. Hair, feet, and nails done, and I still ice cream.
You know what I'm saying? My mother may come down occasionally and kick her rhyme that she's been kicking for the last 12 years. Cool. It's cool, Ma. And my little sister, she don't care. You know what I mean? Once in a while, she'll come home like, oh, one of my friends said, you know, you're Lady Luck, and they want an autograph. I'm like, get out of here.
I'm gonna keep pushing and keep doing what I do, regardless of who wants me in whatever industry, you know, because there's always independency. And when people believe in you and you believe in yourself and you pull a family and a team together, it can all manifest. It can all manifest.
I went back to school. I have a degree in psychology. I have my own practice. I listen to people's problems now for a living instead of telling people mine. And I have three beautiful children, two by birth, one by adoption. And I'm just loving life. That's basically it.
It's a whole lot with the industry, and that's why I decided to just go into the law side of it. I didn't want to be an artist anymore. I don't want to really write records anymore. I mean, I was writing still during my hiatus. I was in school. I went to school to get my bachelor's, and now I want to go to law school so I can get my law degree and be an entertainment attorney.
I'm senior vice president of A&R at Flavia Unit Records, like I said, which is Queen Latifah's label.
Technically, I'm still signed to Death Row, and right now I'm in the process of trying to get off of Death Row. You know, I've been down with them, and I tried to do the loyal thing, and I mean, I held out just as long as I can. If they're not doing anything for me, and I'm just sitting around, you know, getting old and decrepit, then, you know, I got to go. I got to go, you know, somewhere where somebody is gonna say, look, Rage, we believe in you, and we want you to do this, and we're willing to put this into you, do your thing. Now, the label I'm on right now, they're not doing that, and I gotta go. I mean, you know, they put me on, Death Row exposed the world to Rage, and Rage tried to be down with Death Row as long as she could, but now, you know, it's just not happening anymore, and, you know, I gotta cut my ties and just move on.
I'm a radio air personality with the new 92.3 The Beat here in Los Angeles. I still rap. Occasionally on other people's stuff, but I write magazine articles for like rap pages, some internet stuff.
Well, right now I'm putting out a couple of white labels on my own. I have a group, Familiar Faces, featuring Q45, Bees, and Devo. It's like a whole clique that we have that we might be starting our own label with in the near future. So right now it's just a whole lot of open doors. I'm pretty much taking my time into jumping into another deal. You know, I want to start over. I want to start from scratch.
Now that this is done and said, I would like to thank Miss MC for really giving females a chance to voice exactly what's going on in hip-hop and what's happening with them. And hopefully other sisters can take this on and take it to the next level. And I will see y'all when they do it again.
Yo, what's up? This is Salt from Salt and Pepper, and I want to give a shout out to Miss MC. Big up to y'all for giving females a chance to voice their opinion.
I really want to thank, big up to Miss MC for having me doing this documentary.
I thank Miss MC for having me here so I can voice my opinion.
Stay tight. Be real with yours. Nikki D, and I'm the fuck out of here.
I really appreciate being a part of this.
I want to give a big shout out and much love and blessings to Miss MC.
Yo, this is Charlie Baltimore signing out, and I gotta say thanks to my girl, Miss MC, for giving females the power, the voice, the courage, and, you know what I'm saying, the outlet to let other females know what it's like in this rap game. And I hope that y'all take heed to these messages that y'all learning in here today.
Thanks for Miss MC for letting us speak our voice.
And I'd like to close this by saying peace to Miss MC and thank you for having me up here to tell my story about the struggle.
Peace out to Miss MC for giving females the opportunity to be down. You know what I'm saying?
I just want to thank Miss MC for giving a chance to a struggling artist like me.
Shout out to Miss MC, you know what I mean?
And I'd like to thank Miss MC for giving us females a chance, you know, to express ourselves and, you know, for the world to get to listen to our struggles, being a woman in a rap game.
For me on all the night, so bring them diamonds, bring it out. Just make sure that you keep in mind.
My name is Cheryl James, and I'm originally from Brooklyn, New York.
Yo, what's up? This is the Big Kahuna. That's right. Pep's in the house. This is Pep from Salt and Pepper. That's right.
Hi, I'm Nikki D. Some might remember me as the first female rapper on Def Jam.
Yo, what's up? This is Heather B. Coming straight from Jersey City, New Jersey. Word up.
The Lady of Rage is from Farmville, VA. Virginia, that is, for those who don't know.
What's up? I'm Queen Pen. I'm from Brooklyn.
How y'all doing? Name is Marijuana. Like the new hottest female rapper out from Jersey.
My name is Charlie Baltimore, and I'm from Philadelphia. West Philly, representing West Philly.
Peace. This is Rod, the first and only female to flip Mode Squad, coming to you live.
My name is Shireen Newton now. I'm married. I'm from the group Finesse and Quiz.
Yo, 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 what up? This champ, the Gosso, AKA Shorty Bartha, the Scorpion, Venom number 4.
Yo, yo, what up? This is Jay Boone,
Venom number one, aka Viper the Swashes, representing Queensbridge, baby.
What's up? This is the POTUS representing with the Miss MC documentary.
My name is Bonnie Clyde from the Bronx.
My name is Preta Honey Dark from Far Rockaway, Queens.
How you doing? I'm Lady Luck, Def Jam's new recording artist. I'm originally from my father's nutsack. I went to my mother's womb. I spent 9 months in there. And then after that, you know, we're moving around like gypsies.
What's up, y'all? This is Camille Young representing Dirty Jersey.
What's up, everybody? My name is Steph Lover. That's L-O-B-A, all right? Don't get it twisted.
I'm Medusa, representing West Coast, representing Feline Science, and right now, representing Miss MC.
When you're the first at something, usually they say, okay, well, you bust open doors. But no, when I got in hip hop, the doors were still held open for you.
Those who try to disrespect me, you better cut that crap or get slapped. Cause Shantae is back on the map, hitting hard as a cannonball, and still I'm standing tall with no delay. Shantae's commanding y'all.
You know, I may have bust open doors as far as being the first female to do it, but then it wasn't as competitive as it is now. It wasn't as shiesty as it is now, even though they were still there stealing and thieving, and you know, and I have had a lot stolen.
Me and Sandy met in college. We were going to community college, and we were in our first year.
And that was my girl. We was just hanging out, and then we also worked at the same job, which was Sid's.
Kid and Play worked there. I think y'all heard this before, but Martin Lawrence worked there. Our producer Herbie Lovebug worked there, and he was going to a school called Center for the Media Arts in Manhattan. He had to do a project, whereas he had to have actually press a record, go to the pressing plant, and come back with a mastered record.
I wrote the rhymes, gave it to them, asked them if they would do it. They said, yeah, yeah, sure, sure, whatever. And
he asked me and Pep to do the vocals. I was like, yo, we could do this. Y'all could be Salt and Pepper. It ended up being the Showstopper, which is the answer to Dougie Fresh and Slick Rick's The Show.
And I was like, I'm not dissing Dougie Fresh and Slick Rick. Are you mad? You know, Lottie Dottie, are you crazy? So he was like, yo, I'm telling you, we could do this. So we went into the attic, in Herbie's attic, started doing music, put the music together, made a tape.
And we got our foot in the door. This little independent record label called us. They still owe us money, and they pressed the record for us.
And from then on, they were just, you know, just kept doing it.
So before you know it, clubs was calling us, and we was traveling, doing shows. We quit our jobs, we quit school, and the rest is history.
My first solo banger was Daddy's Little Girl. And basically, I'm born and raised in Newark, New Jersey. And we got to a point in life where my mother got to a point in life where she wanted to switch up and change. So we wound up moving to LA. I wound up going to high school for the 4 years out there, and that's where I started rapping at. Got involved with Ice-T, Evil E, who was a DJ, and the LA Posse, who actually got me a demo done so it can go into Russell Simmons' hands and he can actually hear it.
I gotta say that Russell's like daddy to me. No, Russell, first let me say that I love you. Russell gave me the opportunity to start my career and be part of such a big industry that had no love for females, especially female rappers at that point. And once he put me on, I couldn't do nothing but shine for him, and he gave me a big record, Daddy's Little Girl.
But I mean, in the midst of all of that, it was really not as easy as I make it sound because I was 18. You know, me and my friend was like, okay, hey, we're just gonna sell the Volkswagen Bug and we're gonna get our little $1,000 and we're gonna buy some bus tickets and we're gonna go over to New York and we're gonna get this record done and we're gonna get this deal. So, you know, me being the trooper that I am, I lied to my mother. I was like, Russell waiting for me, Ma. She was like, you know, ain't nobody waiting for you over there. I was like, Ma, Russell's waiting for me. He wanted me to come. The contract is already there. Because when I was about 15, 16, I signed away some crazy deal with some lady doing a soundtrack that never came out, but she had gotten my publisher for it. My mother thought that was crazy, so after that, she was like, don't sign no more papers. Whatever the case, me and my friend Dawn, we just, you know, we blacked out. We came to New York, because the producers were out in New York, the LA Posse. And they was like, well, if you get out here, you know what I'm saying, we can sneak you in the studio, we can do your demo, la la la. So basically, that's what happened. Snuck me in, we did two songs. They got it over to Russell, because they were working on LL Cool J's album.
and they got it over to Russell.
I basically got started in 92 with KRS-One and Boogie Down Productions. I went to school with Kenny Parker, who was Chris's brother, and that's how we hooked up. And it was ill, because at the time, Boogie Down Productions was like, bam, like on top. And it was just, I don't know, it was just perfect timing for me to get in. And Chris was a good teacher, someone to learn from, especially how to write songs. He took me out traveling. I just basically spent 2 years just traveling and writing and doing things and how to become an artist before I came out with my own record.
I used to write poetry a lot. And when I first heard the Sugar Hill Gang and Grandmaster Flash, that was just an extension of poetry. You know, it just had music added to the element. So I figured, you know, this is something I can do. And I started writing when I was like 10, 11. I met a lot of people. Even though people were up on my skills and everything, nobody really took an interest in me. I worked with Eric B for a while. I was down with Nikki D, the LA Posse, who worked with LL Cool J, and then Chubb Rock. And Chubb Rock was about to do something with me until that's when Dre called for me. I got a call. I was working at Chung King Studios, also living there for those who know the story. And I got a call from Dre. He was like, Dre and Suge, and they were like, we heard you on the LA Posse compilation. We're forming a new rap label, or new record label, and we wanted to know if you wanted to be down with it. And I was like, well, how do I know you're Dr. Dre? And he's like, there's only one way to find out. And they sent me a ticket.
I rock rough and stuff with my Afro punks.
Rock on with your man.
If you look at back in the days, it was at the time where I started when I was like 14, 15, wasn't much at that time for us to do but to hang on the corner and rhyme. And the guys around my way where I grew up used to always rhyme, and I just started writing rhymes. I started out by writing songs, but that's how my moms found my songs and took them from me because I was not doing right in school. So I just started writing rhymes because it was easier to hide them from her. So that's how I basically started rhyming. I used to be in Virginia or whatever, and a friend of mine that's locked up now was close with Teddy. And I used to be around Teddy, but I didn't want to bull ride and say, yo, Teddy, I could rhyme. And one day I told him, he was like, word, come to the studio. So I went down to the studio, I rhymed for him, and he was honest with me. He said, yo, I can't do nothing for you right now, but I'm trying to get my own deal, my own label, and when I do, I'm gonna come back for you. And when he did No Diggity, which was 2 years later, he found me in Brooklyn.
She's a magnificent. The queen.
Writing poetry, you know, in like second, third grade, and I guess it just kind of developed into, you know, rapping.
Who's the one who came in vicious? Everything I touch is y'all want to get it. Cats want to hit it. Hype when I spit it. What y'all do did it. Want to get it? Want to get rich? I'm going to show you money. And you want a hot chick? Gotta throw your money. Why you want to hate me? I don't owe you money. Y'all cats got late fees. I don't owe you money.
I think by the time I was in sixth and seventh grade, that's when Big Daddy Kane first came out with Raw. That's what I remember, me writing a rap, me listening to that and just being really inspired to try to rap like him and be like him and write a rhyme. And went to school and like spit for the boys that was in my class. And they used to be like, yo, you sound like Big Daddy Kane. So we would go in the schoolyard and battle, and I was like the only girl in my class that raps. It was just crazy that I worked in the gallery in Philly, which is like a little mall, like in the center of Philly. And I was like about 14 or 15. And Will Smith came in the mall. And God forbid he would remember this, which I doubt he would, but he came in the mall and he was in the Athlete's Foot. And I ran out of the store that I worked in and got him in, you know, the hallway and rapped for him.
you know, and I gave him my number, and he actually called and was like, yo, you know, you should come out. I think that you would be hot. You know, you got skills. And, like, I lived with my sister, and she was like, you know, you can't go out after such and such a time. So it kind of, you know, discouraged me from doing it. And, of course, it started back up again when I met Big, you know, and I was just playing around one day, rapped. It was just as simple as him telling me to keep writing, you know, and which I did. So for like 2 years, you know, I just kept writing, improving my skill from years of not writing, you know. So it didn't take long for me to be able to write songs, and I didn't really know how to structure them well, but I mean, you know, all that came in time, so.
Basically, it's been a long time coming for me, you know what I'm saying? For those of y'all that know me personally, I've been rhyming since a little teeny tiny girl at the age of 12, elementary school. From there, I just basically continue writing throughout high school.
Flip mode, outsiders, tight, down to the
ground. Hey, man.
Yeah, check it.
And
I say what's tight, cause it's just the right rhymes all day and all night. Dwelling south with a Hudson, New Jerusalem, in seclusion, using fake pseudonyms.
I'm true fact.
Mind travels like a schizo on two tabs with do-rags hanging from my pockets. Need a rap to go back to pediatrics. Early left rappers like you were straight vested. So recognize.
We decided to pursue this as a career in my early years of college. I left college, and from that point on, I was basically broke. All the way up until the time I got a record deal. So for all you aspiring artists, you know what I'm saying, just stick with your dreams and it'll definitely happen. A little bit about myself personally. I come from Brick City, Newark, New Jersey.
First thing first, I started as a solo artist. You know what I'm saying? We ain't gonna talk about the label because it don't mean nothing. You know what I'm saying? But I'm with a group now, you know what I'm saying? And I think we top dogs, we top choice in this bitch, you know what I'm saying? We run this motherfucker right here. And I feel like, yo, straight up, we write our own fucking lyrics. You know what I'm saying? That's first thing first. I think we get pops for that. Cause a lot of motherfuckers be here, motherfuckers rapping and shit. Oh, that shit is hot? Yeah, but your man wrote it, you know what I'm saying? And niggas is getting credit for shit they ain't do. But you know what I'm saying? I'm not the one to bite your motherfucking head off. I just do me. You know what I'm saying?
Back in 1980, somewhere around that time. I think I was like eight or, I don't know, I'm 27 now, so I started rhyming when I was like eight. When I was in Brooklyn, what happened was the people on the block used to battle each other verse to verse, and they used to win money. They used to get money from each other that way. And so what I used to do when I was little is I used to go up and recite other people's rhymes. At that time, I wasn't really into writing or anything like that. And I would battle those, you know,